Good morning, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us today. I'm your host, Peggy Tuck. Now, today's webinar focuses on addressing the challenges of maintaining rotating equipment for both onshore and offshore platforms. First, I want to tell you a little bit about the featured company. Sulzer is a leading service provider for rotating equipment and leading pump manufacturer. They specialize in high-quality, cost-effective, customized solutions for maintenance and repairs of all makes and models of turbo machinery, pumps, generators, and motors. Sulzer helps keep equipment operating at peak efficiency, which in turn saves companies very valuable dollars. Our presenters today are Joe Sedbury. He is the General Manager Operations for Sulzer Electromechanical Services. Aaron Burton, Lead Field Engineer, Rotating Equipment Services Field Engineer for Sulzer Pump Services. And Kirill Grebnik, he is the Lead Engineer at Sulzer Rotating Equipment Services. We will be taking all of your questions following the presentation. To submit, if you'll just look at the bottom right-hand side of, or left-hand side, excuse me, of your screen, you will see a section to submit your questions. And now we're going to get things kicked off. I'd like to introduce you to Joe Sedbury, General Manager Operations for Sulzer Electromechanical Services. Joe has been involved in the industrial apparatus service business for over 50 years. Over half of that time was spent with General Electric, serving as a technician, field services and application engineer, service sales engineer, and motor generator specialist, in addition to managing several of GE's apparatus and engineering service centers. He also operated his own business, specializing in motor repair and general contracting. It's my pleasure to introduce you to Joe Sedbury.
Good morning. As we discussed, we're going to be talking about motor failures and repair methods for both your onshore and offshore platforms. We want to focus on critical motors, and we all know that any motor can become critical at any given time, but we normally look at the larger horsepower machines when we tend to think of identifying what motors are critical to that operation, and that's simply because we don't have spares available for the larger motors. So we're going to talk about some of the more frequently encountered failures that we see in the repair shops, some of the things you can do to extend the life of your motors, as well as the repair methods we would use on your critical motors. Studies throughout the years have traditionally shown bearing and mechanical failures are the major source of problems in electric motors. And they represent over 50 to 51%. Stator windings, you're looking at 16 to 20%, depending on the study, as well as rotor bars, which is represented 5% on this graph, but traditionally we're seeing more and more rotor bar problems. Bearings, as we know, come in different sizes, different types. You have ball bearings as well as sleeve bearings. We normally encounter the ball bearings on the smaller machines, 500 horsepower and below, and the sleeve bearings on the larger motors. When we look at what causes bearings to fail, we turn to companies like SKF and FAG bearings, whatever, and they do studies about every 5 years, and they're seeing improper lubrication is a major problem in causing bearing failures. We see this number anywhere from 36 to 50%. Improper lubrication in their language could be too much lubrication, not enough lubrication, the wrong type of lubrication, the wrong oils and bases that are incompatible with one another, and that represents the majority. Improper preloads and overloads, this is due to your mounting, your coupling lockup, and things like that that we see. But improper lubrication is something that over the years we see more and more of. And out of that improper lubrication, we see more and more of it as too much lubrication as opposed to not enough lubrication. We all know what ball bearing over lubrication looks like when we look in there and we see the grease is packed solid. If your inbell and your bearings are packed solid with grease, that leads to what they call false or plastic lubrication, in which the rollers don't have time to shed their temperatures for their high heat into air because it's totally packed with grease. So the main thing is, if you look at lubrication charts, you'll see that we over-grease our bearings far more, and it takes very little grease to re-lubricate a bearing. Oil-lubricated bearings are a little bit different. We have to maintain a certain level of oil in these reservoirs, and we're looking at not too much oil, because what happens is we're depending on this brass ring to revolve in and out of the oil and cover this oil and bring it to the top and lubricate your shaft. If you have too much, it creates drag on this ring and slows the ring down, which slows your lubrication down. So the main thing is, don't overfill. Look at your sight glass on the side of the motor. It's designed to be measured with your motor at standstill, and you look and see if the oil level is the midpoint of your sight glass. Don't overfill it, because it will go down when you start rotating. The oil level will look low, but if you fill it full of oil at that point, you'll start leaking oil out of these openings, and you'll have oil on the outside of your motor. Stator problems. Stator problems pretty much look the same, whether they're a hydro, such as this picture, or your generators, your synchronous motors, your induction motors. It's all coils stacked in laminated stacks of iron. The biggest problem we see is oil and dirt. Especially in your oil-lubricated bearings, you'll have a film of oil surrounding your winding sometimes if you have oil leaks. Once the oil gets on your motor, it collects dirt, in this case coal dust. As you leave the oil on the windings, it will saturate the insulation, soften it, and allow it to be penetrated by any kind of electrical sparks. Unfortunately, the only thing you can do is keep your windings clean. You have to, whether you clean them on site or you pull them out and send them in the shop, you have to keep that winding clean. Moisture and corrosion, for all of us operating in the Gulf Coast area, this is the problem we live with every day. The main thing is to, if you see the salt accumulation or the corrosion, take your motor out, send it in for recondition, clean it and dry it out, and put new coating of insulation over the top of the wire. Thermal aging or thermal degradation is something we see all the time. We don't always recognize it for what it is, but as your insulation gradually dries out, it will start looking old and brittle. The overloads on your motor, your voltage variations, whether it's nameplate to incoming power or phase-to-phase voltage variations, have a lot to do with this. So watch your voltage. Make sure your filters stay clean. Minimize your overloads. If you have this, pull your motor out and have it reconditioned. It's the best thing you can do. Coil movement is a bigger problem than we realize because we don't always see it. But these coils are vibrating at 120 times per second when this motor is energized. And they're literally trying to pull these coils out of the slots with this movement. The manufacturers and the rebuilders tie these off with support rings and everything else in order to minimize this movement. But it's impossible to make one homogeneous mass out of these coils, because they're designed to flex and bend whatever so the insulation don't tear. So you have to keep a close eye on this coil movement. And this is caused by rapid starting, long acceleration times, voltage variations, surge conditions on your line power, whatever is causing these phases. In this case, phase A tries to separate from phase B, tries to separate from phase C. When this happens, it tears the insulation, your motor will blow to ground or have turn-to-turn faults. So the big idea for rewinding, maintaining your motors, is to control that movement. And here's what happens. This is a cross-section of a stator slot. And in this case, the coils are in crooked, which we'll talk about in a few minutes. But these coils need to be a tight fit in here in order to control the movement, because you're moving inside your slots, as well as up and down out here on your interns. You have tangential movement out here where one phase is trying to go one way, one phase is trying to go another way. And in the meantime, all these turns of magnet wire inside of your coil is vibrating against one another. And this will lead to what they call a turn-to-turn short. And in studies of different industries over the years, we find that probably 70% of the failures are initiated with a turn-to-turn fault. So anything we can do to control these movements is a long way towards lengthening the life of your motor. So we have to keep an eye on this bracing. When motors come into our shop, we look for indications of vibration to see if these ties are coming loose, the tangential blocking is coming loose, surge ropes are coming loose, whatever. If you've changed your operation and say your equipment is taking longer to accelerate, or your voltage has changed, or your ambient condition has changed, whatever, we need to go in and change this blocking in order to secure these windings. So if you send a motor in and it's failed early, tell us, and then we'll find out, has your operation changed, or is it just your coil itself is loosening due to age? This is what the bracing looks like. You have your coils made of copper. This is actually fiberglass strands saturated in epoxy, thermosetting epoxy. When this sets up, this is like a steel ring. It's very strong. So we tie all of our coils off to that. We tie them on the bottom. We tie them to the inside. We have tangential blocking to keep these coils from moving side to side. All these tapes set up, they're thermosetting tapes. They will shrink a little bit, even though we have them tight, and pull your winding together, because we are trying to create a homogeneous mass with the coils as much as we can. So this is all done before the BPI processes, which set your coils in further. But the blocking is very important. As you have your motors rewind, take a look at this. Make sure you have adequate blocking in your motor rewinds. These next few slides come from a major manufacturer when they were trying to study just how important it is for coil fits in your slots and the effect of any unfilled space on your copper coil temperature. In a motor design, what you're trying to do, you have a lot of heat generated inside this coil as your motor develops torque. We try to dissipate that heat by having the coil fit tight against these laminations. If we do that, you know, we can control the temperature rise of your motor. So the goal is to have no airspace between the coil and the iron. So how do we do that? We make the coil fit the slot. In this particular case, this was the first motor out of four individual motors. They made the coil fit the slot correctly like it should be. They put it on a dynamometer and loaded it up. At full load, they only had 100 degrees centigrade rise, which was the design nameplate temperature rise. On the second machine, they purposely made an undersized coil. They left 30,000th airspace over here to be filled with varnish or whatever. Same voltage, same load, whatever. We had a 35 degree C increase in the temperature. This one was made with coils which tilted in the slot. They didn't fit the slot straight. So we had 30,000 here, 30,000 here, and we had 147 degree rise. So it's a lot hotter than the last one, same load. This coil was made undersized and has airspace on either side of it. And air is not a good heat transfer. We had 53 degrees centigrade rise over the original design. So the idea is you want your coil to fit the slot. This is especially important on your higher voltage machines, 6,600 volts and above, to make that coil fit the slot. So how do we do it? Again, you know, fit the slot. The shape of your coil has a big influence on how this fits. This is the type of the coil we use on your higher voltage machines. This is made with an epoxy-saturated tapes. It goes into a press. It's pressed to be a very, very tight fit in your slot. So each side of your coil is pressing against the laminations. You're getting maximum heat transfer from your coil to the laminations, and the laminations are cooled off by the air turbulence in the motor as it's operating. This is what you'll see in a global BPI setup here. You'll see the tapes are pretty loose. They may fit in the middle of the coil, but they don't fit at the top and the bottom of the coil because they don't have a straight structure to the coil. varnish the BPI resin. We'll get in here and collect, and hopefully when you pull it out of the dip tank, it doesn't drain out. But it's hard to get resin to stay in here in the larger spaces. So make sure whoever's rewinding your motors uses a hot pressed coil section to maximize the fill in that slot. Rotors, this happens to be a cylindrical generator rotor getting ready to go into our high-speed balance pits. Rotors all made the same, rotor body, shaft, journals. The biggest problem we see anymore is broken rotor bars in induction motors and also the amortisher cage of synchronous motors because they both start the same way. Your magnetic lines of force when you first start cuts into the bar. They're connected out here to the end ring. So at any time, this could be a north pole, south pole, north pole, south pole. But these are designed to carry current, and the current is what produces the torque as you're trying to start your motor. If this copper gets too hot, it'll start melting and breaking. And during acceleration, the temperature in these rotor bars can increase 100 degrees centigrade per second. So the copper gets extremely hot, and then it becomes pliable. And these bars start breaking due to long acceleration times, multiple starts, you know, whatever. The bad thing is if you break one of these bars, the bars on either side of the broken bar have to carry extra current, and they soon burn out. They'll run so hot, you can see the discoloration of the bars, it actually starts melting the steel in your laminations. So if you let your rotor get to this point, it becomes a very expensive repair. You may have to replace laminations as well as rotor bars. So if you ever walk by your motor, the first indication you're going to hear, if you have a broken rotor bar, you're going to hear a cyclic humming noise, like a That's an indication that you have a cracked rotor bar somewhere. Try to catch it, repair it as soon as you can. Fortunately, these rotors can be repaired, but what happens is your magnetic lines of force on starting penetrate only the top part of your bar. So the top part of your bar gets very hot, the bottom part of your bar is very cool, and it forms this parabolic bend in your bars. The parabolic bend forces the total bar down on the end, start right, and you'll have stress risers. Centrifugal force, as your rotor comes up to speed, it bends it the other way, which forms stress risers on the bottom. So if you can minimize the number of starts or the reclosures and shorten your acceleration times, you'll go a long way to preventing this. Rotors can be repaired. We make new shafts, new laminations, new bars. We do it on induction machines. We do it on synchronous machines. We do it on some of the solid pole, high-speed synchronous rotors. Synchronous motors, fortunately, are pretty reliable motors, and they are because they're designed to start under no load, so they have very little stress on them during acceleration times. The biggest problem we see on synchronous machines is trying to start them without reducing the load. They're designed to start under no load, so if your cylinders are still full of air, your pumps are still full of water, whatever, the load is just too much for synchronous motors. Sometimes they won't start. Sometimes they won't latch into synchronous speed, and you have to make sure all the load is off of them. The next biggest part is these motors are designed to start and run 4 or 5 years sometimes. These electrical components will start breaking down. They'll start rusting, breaking down, whatever. So always make sure that you have a complete set of SCRs, diodes, transistors if you have them, filters, and your synchronizing boxes. These are hard to get on short notice, so if you don't have them, you're going to be down for a long time. A lot of manufacturers, a lot of customers are going to split wheels. They have a whole wheel complete, and they just split it, bolt it back on, and they're back in operation. So that's what we suggest to all of our customers. This is what you're going to see on the platforms, the offshore platforms a lot. This is what the synchronous high-speed machines look like. They're made out of a solid forging, separable caps, or in G's case, a solid forging, with caps before it's into it. Very reliable machine, as long as this exposed copper doesn't get a lot of dirt in it or you have a lot of movement. Very reliable machines. Testing, if you send your motors in for repair or recondition, always make sure that they're tested at full voltage after repair. If there's a problem in there, we want to find on the test panel and not when 2 o'clock in the morning when you're putting it in on your platform. Your repair shop should have AC and DC voltages available up to 13 kV to allow for full synchronization of some of these synchronous motors. Some of them are AC synchronous, some of them are DC synchronous, but you need 2 test panels. In this case, we have 5,000 volt, 13,000 volt here. Your motor should always be tested on an isolated steel test bed, which you see here, because any vibration that's in that motor, you want isolated from any vibration that could be occurring out here. So always test them on a solid steel vibration isolated test bed. And if you have use for a dynamometer, make sure your shop has a dynamometer like this to add load. So that's it. It's short, fast. We had a time constraint. Be glad to answer any questions you may have. If you don't get in time, get us on our email, and we'll be glad to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Joe Sedbury. And once again, I do want to remind you, if you would like to submit a question, we will be taking those at the end of the presentation. Just look to the bottom left of your screen, and you can put your questions in, and we'll get to all of them following the presentation. Now we'd like to move on. I'd like to introduce you to Aaron Burton. He's the lead field engineer for Sulzer Pump Services. Aaron joined the Sulzer team in 2010, and with over 12 years of experience in pump services, he currently leads a team of engineers supporting Houston and Odessa service centers. His team provides technical solutions and design assistance to customers and repair facilities for specific and highly engineered pumping needs. Some of Aaron's work and presentations have been covered and showcased by World Pipeline Magazine and the Vibration Institute. It's my pleasure now to introduce you to Aaron Burton.
Thank you very much and good morning. Today I'm going to talk a little bit about hydraulic re-rates and some of the basic offerings that that Sulzer is typically putting out into the market. Throughout the life of a pump, the original hydraulic requirements may change significantly as the product demands change. It is often prohibitively expensive to modify piping and foundation arrangements to replace the original pump with a new one that will satisfy the new requirements. Hydraulic re-rates are often used to change the performance of a pump and meet the new requirements without the need to change the existing piping and foundation configuration at a greatly reduced cost. So throughout this presentation, I'll go ahead and give you a few different examples of the modifications that we typically run into, as well as some actual field examples and jobs that we have created and completed during my time here at Sulzer. So to start off, we'll begin with the shortest and I guess simplest of the modifications that we would look into. This would include a trim or an increased sized impeller. Now, when we're changing the impeller size, it's really only going to change the hydraulics and operation of the pump in basic affinity law fashion. That is, as the impeller trim increases, the flow rate is going to increase in a direct fashion, head at the square, and then horsepower at the cube of the difference in the impeller trim. Outside of that, we will also, from time to time, recommend underfiling. And underfiling is again, a very simple change that that we will implement to an impeller to where the backside of a vane is slightly ground to reduce this area here and open up the overall outlet area of the impeller itself. Doing this can increase the overall flow of the impeller and essentially push out the best efficiency point. Now, the one thing to remember about this particular modification is the results you will typically see are in the neighborhood of 2 to 5% increase in the BEP flow point. Now, another modification we may put out for a suggestion, if you've got a change in rated capacity that is going to require an additional 10 or 15% or maybe 10 or 15% less than the original duty point, we can come in and do several modifications to the volute case itself. Now, along with a trim in the impeller diameter or application of underfiling, even the implementation of a new impeller, Sulzer may come in and modify the volute lip of the actual case. Now, modifying the volute lip right here, either extending it or cutting it back, will typically change the inlet area of that volute, allowing for either less or more flow to pass through the volute nozzle area. Now, this is called a change in the Y ratio, which is a method that is used to determine and predict the changes in hydraulics as the areas from the impeller to the volute change. Finally, we may go through a very major modification, and this can get you in the neighborhood of 20 to 30% more or less flow, depending on the type of work conducted to the original pump. Now, this is normally always going to require a new impeller, and along with the impeller, it may be an extension or reduction of the volute lip, which is going to change the area. And if we are going to go to extreme changes, there may be changes to the sidewalls. So the front to back is changed with the location of the volute lip, but we may weld in plates in the sidewalls or open up the sidewalls to further increase the area. Now to go into some examples of how these are implemented throughout the pumps. This particular case was a refinery in Texas that had a very high demand duty for a particular pump. These are some simple single-stage overhung pumps, rather large 8x10 21 pumps that were in really a not very good operation point based on the original selection for these pumps. And this is very very common throughout the industry to see the demands change in this fashion. But the way these pumps were typically ran by the customer, they were getting about an 18-month mean time between failure, which was costing a lot of money for each repair as it would come in. So in order to increase this mean time between failure, the customer came to Sulzer asking for some kind of modification that could help meet their needs and also, you know, increase their repair schedule so that they weren't pulling this pump every 18 months. So we asked for several pieces of information. You know, number one is the process conditions that the pump is currently subjected to, along with vibration readings and a history of this pump as it's gone through its life. Now, this is some of the information that was provided to us. You know, the major point that we saw here was the pump is constantly run at a very, very, very low flow rate, much, much lower than the minimum continuous stable flow that is on the pump curve itself. It also had a four-vane impeller and a dual volute case design, which was causing a very high vane pass vibration. So the combination of a very low flow rate and the four-vane impeller and the dual volute design created a very, very high vane pass at four times the operating speed, which can be seen right here. This is about 120 hertz, which is right at four times the 1800 RPM operating speed, indicating that the vane pass was causing a major, major issue and was a key contributor to the failures of this pump. In addition, the suction-specific speed was very high for this particular impeller, and running at such a low flow rate, there was going to be a lot of suction recirculation and a lot of suction instabilities. So to recap on the previous slide, as I said before, the four-vane impeller with the dual volutes causes a simultaneous pressure pulsation each time a blade passes. So in a different odd number configuration, you wouldn't have this this simultaneous pulsation happening at every pass. So this is essentially doubling the vibration signature as the pump is operating. Again, the off-peak operation increased the energy of the suction with suction recirculation, causing a lot of cavitation and instability of the flow. And finally, I think the largest problem with this request was the flow rate conditions that the customer is requesting. They wanted to be able to operate this pump at both 950 gallons a minute and 2,000 gallons a minute. Now, to fit this within a curve and still have, you know, a marginally sufficient operating range, you know, this is a very, very tough task to be able to hit. So with all this information, you know, and the help of the Sulzer Advanced Engineering, we did come up with an impeller design that would meet the customer's requested conditions. The first thing that we needed to do was to change this to an odd vane count impeller and get rid of that constant double vane pulsation with the four-vane impeller. We also needed to modify the volute. As I said before, the 20% operation of best efficiency is not a good operating point for any pump to run at. So we needed to close down the volute area to reduce the overall flow requirements and put this pump operating in a good portion of the curve. Also, we wanted to reduce the suction-specific speed to stabilize the suction energy and the flow coming into the impeller and reduce cavitation. So this is the curve of the pump after we did the modifications. This was a proposal curve that was supplied to the customer. And as you can see, you know, we were a little high on their expectations for the differential head at their high flow rate, but it was set at a good position of best efficiency according to API. You know, this is the max that we would select a pump is 120% of best efficiency. But with that, we were also able to maintain the low flow rate of 950 gallons a minute and be above the expected minimum stable flow rate. So with this, the customer is able to operate along the curve and reduce vibration and increase their mean time between repair. And comparatively to the original design of the pump, the BEP was significantly reduced, as you can see, by over half from 4,000 gallons a minute down to 1,700 gallons a minute. And this was the key to really optimizing the flow rates that the customer is running at. With all these changes, we expected the API vibration limits to be retained within this new configuration. Here's a look at the modifications we implemented for this particular pump. There was a lot of casework that had to be done to reduce the nozzle area to better meet the performance requirements. So you can see up here, this was the original location of the volute lip. And this area right here is what had to be changed to achieve the stable flow along the customer's requirements. So this volute lip was welded up to close down that area, and then we installed side plates on either side. And you can see here's a cutaway view, and then here's a view of the nozzle itself as those side plates are installed. And this is the final view. As you can see, the key to installing these plates is really providing a good transition so as not to provide any additional eddies and restrictions outside of the original intent of the modification. For a capacity increase, this was a job for a very large barrel pump, or a BB5. The customer was really very, very short on the amount of flow that they were wanting for a debottlenecking project. A 54% increase of flow was requested, and that's a very, very tall order for any kind of pump. And honestly, with the equipment that was in the field, there was going to be very little opportunity to modify the originally supplied hydraulics of this particular pump. So in evaluating the new requirements and the existing barrel in the field, Sulzer was able to design a completely new inter-rotating element and bundle. The hydraulics department was able to essentially shove in all new impellers with a much larger throat and discharge area, as well as make an inner case that was very, very compact for a volute style pump. In this, we were able to come up with a prediction curve. As you can see, the original pump curve is here in the red, and the new in the blue. And this is a very, very large increase in rated duty point for any pump of this size. And finally, look at the differences between the two pump configurations. Over here on the right was the original impeller. As you can see, the outlet width of the discharge vanes is about an inch, and the increase was about 44% to the new impellers. Additionally, these two nozzles are to scale. It shows you the change in the nozzle size to achieve the customer's requested duty point. We did do a test on this pump. Here's a couple pictures of it on the test stand. And it did operate as expected. And the customer is very happy with this particular re-rate. So, yeah, if you think the 54% increase is a lofty goal, we do have even more opportunity with barrel pumps in particular to get even more flow out of them. Sulzer has a unique position in that all of these volute-style pumps or RCP pumps may have an opportunity to be re-rated with a diffuser-style pump insert or cartridge. This can give us an additional flow of 80% over the original throughout our modeling and testing. This is a viable solution for big debottlenecking projects that we've had a lot of interest in over the past couple of years, with plants trying to increase their throughput of their products. And with that, I want to say thank you for being here on this presentation. And again, if you have questions, I believe we'll be taking them at the end of the webinar. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Aaron Burton, lead field engineer for Sulzer Pump Services. A lot of really good information, and we've got more to come. It's now my pleasure to introduce you to Kirill Grebnik, lead engineer at Sulzer Rotating Equipment Services. With more than 10 years of experience in fluid dynamics, finite element methods, and design of rotating equipment, Kirill is also in charge of Sulzer's program of aerodynamic re-rates and upgrades of turbo machinery. Kirill's area of professional expertise includes a failure analysis, structural and modal analysis, and testing of the equipment and its components. Kirill holds a master's degree in mechanical engineering. And so it's my pleasure to introduce you to Kirill Grebnik.
Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. This is Kirill, and today we're going to be talking about, to finish this webinar, I'm going to be talking about two different topics, and I'll start a little bit with the troubleshooting of the mechanical problems in turbo machinery and give you a general guideline and understanding how we go about, how we approach the troubleshooting topic, and then in the second part of my presentation, I'll be talking about the compressor upgrades and modifications to improve their efficiency and reliability. And let's start with the troubleshooting, and obviously at any point in time, almost mostly any equipment is going to need some kind of a troubleshooting. And we're in the turbomachinery world and the rotating equipment world, we're dealing with a pretty complex equipment, high precision, high tolerances, very high temperatures, pressures, and the problems with these sophisticated designs can be complex as well, and they can exhibit a myriad of symptoms which go along with that. And obviously, for the technician, whether that's the on-site or the outside supplier, it's important to be very quick and effective at diagnosing these problems and troubleshooting the equipment to make sure that the equipment runs stably, or if there is a serious problem, the equipment is being shut down as soon as possible to prevent the long-term, the high-cost damage to it. And troubleshooting begins with a good plan. But to put together a good plan, the technician who's doing this troubleshooting needs to be very well versed in the and have a deep understanding of the equipment, the conditions, what's appropriate and what's inappropriate for this equipment as far as the behavior in the service. So how do we go about developing a plan? When there is a problem, we need to focus on the facts first and understand what kind of data do we have from the machine and what's normal, what's abnormal, and focus on those anomalies within the equipment. After we know what's abnormal, it's wise to develop a plan to go about that troubleshooting and execute the steps and the tests in the plan in the order of their importance. And after each test is done, we definitely need to have a clear answer about yes or no from the test, and then go continue further. Think about, do we need any more further tests, or do the results of this test validate or invalidate the previous results? And definitely drive ourselves to find a solution. Sometimes the solution can be found, or the next steps can be discovered by just thinking about what's problem and what's not, or what's really not a problem in this equipment, and just eliminating a lot of the unnecessary steps to confirm what we already know from the machinery monitoring data or from the response that we're getting from the equipment. But if you're at a standstill, just try forcing the response and try making the machinery to do something and think about the results or what kind of output you're going to get out of the machine. Well, that's real quick on the subject of the troubleshooting. And going further along, I think we have about 10 minutes left before we go and continue with the questions. I wanted to focus on the upgrades and reliability improvements of the compressors in the critical services. Obviously, we're in the 21st century, and we expect that all of the critical rotating equipment is monitored continuously, 24/7, with some proximity probes, with the trips and alarm settings. But the fact that you have a monitoring system in place does not necessarily mean that it's a good system and that it will protect you appropriately, because there could be problems with the hardware setup. There can be there always could be something improved with the software settings, and every year the providers of these instrumentation and protection systems, they coming up with a new and better ideas, better equipment to help you to continuously monitor and protect the equipment. So some of the services that we provide from Sulzer within the Sulzer is configuration of the monitoring system to make sure that it's set up correctly and it's doing what it's supposed to do. Installation, calibration of the transducers. Also, we are very hands-on and can provide and suggest what is the optimum trips and alarm settings for the certain type of equipment, and obviously conversion of the overspeed trip protection systems to the electronic. That's been a recent trend in the industry, a lot safer than the mechanical overspeed trip systems, and that's something that goes along with the services when we're looking at the turbo machinery protection and monitoring equipment. Another big field where a lot of the legacy equipment can be improved is the bearing upgrades, and the bearing upgrades goes along the two avenues. The first one is improving goal is to improve stability by switching the older sleeve tie bearings to the tilt pads and provide just in general more robust design, and there's been a recent trend in the industry. And then second one is upgrading the bearing housings from the spherical to cylindrical seated fits, which helps to improve the alignment of the bearings and make it easier in the field to realign or align the machines. Another big topic in the recent years has been the dry gas seals, and they were around for quite a while, but the general bandages of the dry gas seal versus, especially when you're operating the process which needs to be contained, where you cannot tolerate leakage, is the classic way. The classic design has been oil seals, but they had so many issues, and they are just a little too cumbersome to maintain, and that's why industry is moving towards the dry gas seals with the which have a lot of advantages. They don't have any contact ports, and they have a minimum wear. They have a very robust arrangement with a tandem seal gas supply to create almost zero leakage environment. There are different design separation with a separation seal, again, which the intent is to protect the operators, protect the plant from the leakages, even in case when the primary seal supply fails due to a certain reason. And obviously their advantages are extended seal life, again due to minimum contacting parts, reduced maintenance and reduced downtime compared to oil seals, and a lot less leak points, elimination of the need to for the system to provide the lube oil, provide the seal oil, and so on and so forth. Very conversions to the dry gas seal systems of the older legacy lube oil seal. That's something that can be done on a routine basis. Another big subject that's been advanced over past 20 plus years has been coatings, and there are two different types of coatings, one of them which can be grouped into protective coatings, and the other one is the coatings for restoration of the equipment. The protective coatings, where name speaks for itself, they're intended to increase reliability, protect the gas path or components from the elements, from corrosion, from wear. And restoration coatings can be used to repair fits and restore the damaged areas without needing to weld repairs or replacing the components, which in turn reduces the downtime of the equipment, makes the repairs a lot more efficient, and makes the component extend the component life and service versus where we can recoat versus replace. Speaking of the protective coatings, one of the main types of coatings that are used in the compressors for protecting them from the gases or ambient air under severe service conditions are the air spray coatings. And at Sulzer, we employ three main types of coatings, which AOA and A121 are the aluminum chromate phosphate coatings, where the main intent is to provide a corrosion protection and improve the surface roughness with a different thickness. Of course, they all wear out depending on the severity of service. Nothing expected to last forever, but in general, as they wear out, they are providing a protection to the base metal, and the base metal parts can be, if during repairs, can be restored a lot quicker and may not need as much restoration. Another type of protective coating is A24, and the distinctive difference is that it employs the Teflon base, and it's provides its anti-fouling, and also it provides some degree of corrosion protection. And anti-fouling protection is important when you're speaking about the efficiencies in the gas path. And if the service is notorious for being providing enough fouling elements into and contaminating the gas path, obviously the efficiency is not going to be as high while you're operating this compressor in such service. And this is where that air spray coating comes in place and provides a lot cleaner, or helps to maintain a lot cleaner gas path for a lot longer with it's being applied. Another type of technical improvements is a design upgrade, and this is where the industry is not at the standstill again. Materials can be improved, the designs itself, there's always something to improve into the design, especially if the equipment is known for its high failure rate or unreliability, and this is where we employ our best of our abilities to do the sophisticated engineering and run the all kinds of simulations, do the material testing, analyze the existing part, and provide the recommendations on how to improve, how to make it better, whether that can be done through the redesign, whether that can be done through employing a lot more improved material, a lot more robust material for the application. So all of those aspects can be studied. And to summarize all of what I just said is there's definitely a lot of legacy equipment still out there in the facilities onshore and offshore facilities, and definitely as the industry becomes more and more competitive, there's always a need for reduced downtime, increased operating intervals, and this is where Sulzer can definitely come in and help you by using a lot of its in-shop and field engineering capabilities, employing the state-of-the-art design technologies, graded design, modern seals, improved materials, doing the engineering studies, rotor dynamics, material analysis, design improvements to address the reliability issues and extend the lifetime of the components. Manufacturing the new parts, again, using the state-of-the-art manufacturing techniques and providing even more complex solutions to the industry, providing the along with the advanced repair techniques, which can reduce the downtime and can where the end user can benefit from the extended runtime, as I said, with the applications of the coatings or any other techniques that we use. And finally, in the field, it's critical to for each end user to know that their equipment is monitored and protected to the best of the current day's abilities, and this is, again, another area where we as a soldier can really help and provide the best, provide the advice on setting and configuration of the monitoring and protection system, as well as provide the services with regards to equipment installation, commissioning, field testing, and also on-site project management for complex overhauls, turnarounds that you may encounter. Thank you so much for your time.
This concludes today's webinar. I want to say a very special thanks once again to Sulzer's Joe Sedbury, Aaron Burton, and Kirill Grebnik. I hope everyone has a wonderful day.
The conference has been muted.
Hello.
Hey, Sandra.
Hello.
Should I stop the recording now?
Yes.